بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
And one thing when you go to perform Hajj and you see there are millions of people, you realize how insignificant we are. Doesn't matter how wealthy we are, how educated we are, what a degree we have here, what a power we have here, when we go there we realize we are nobody. We are just a number. There are millions of people who are dying for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are millions of people who are dying for the love of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Alhamdulillahi nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina man yahdihillahu fala mudilla la wa man yudlilhu fala hadiya la ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا اللهم ربي يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم Sadaqallah, Sadaqallahul Aliyul Azim, wa sadaqa Rasuluhun Nabiyul Kareem, wa nahnu ala thalika minash shahideen, amma ba'd. Alhamdulillah, all praises and thanks are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us to be here today to perform the Salatul Jumu'ah and to listen to the khutbah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his peace and blessings onto the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ala alihi wa sahabihi ajma'in and upon his family members and companions insha'Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his mercy upon each and every one of us, to shower his hidayah, his guidance upon us, to shower his forgiveness upon us, and to shower his acceptance upon us. I once more ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his rahmah, his mercy upon me by giving me the permission and the ability to fulfill this responsibility in delivering the khutbah, inshallah. I seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help. I seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower unto me the quality of tawakkal ala Allah, the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the taqwa, the piety, the iman, the faith, the hikmah, the wisdom, the ilm, the knowledge, and the ability to fulfill this responsibility, inshallah. I put my tawakkal, I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most sufficient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. My brothers and sisters, Alhamdulillah, we are still in the month of Dhul Hajj. Today, happens to be the 18th of Dhul-Hajj, and I'm sure there are still hundreds of thousands of people in the Holy Land who have gone to perform the pilgrimage, the Hajj. Alhamdulillah, we here, the Al-Hikmat Hajj group, with the Darul Uloom students and teachers, brothers and sisters, etc. Alhamdulillah, we returned safely, mashallah. Yes, there were a lot of ups and downs. Some fell sick. Little difficulties here and there, buses, food, crowd, etc., etc., etc. And these and those are some of the things that happen during Hajj. That is part of the experience, part of the learning experience. There are some people, fortunately or unfortunately, passed away. Some may say it's a disaster and a calamity. Some may say it's a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they died in the Holy Land. Some may say it's the mistake of the Saudi administration. Whatever it may be, things happen. We have had this year some incidents that never happened in a very, very long time. The 1,000+ people who died in the stampede at the Jamrat, when they went to Pel Shaitan. You've had the rain, thunder, lightning, the falling of the crane. Hundreds died. But at the end of the day, my brothers and sisters, this will still not stop people from going to perform the Hajj. That's very interesting. It will not stop. Because people go out of the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you're aware of the very famous saying, many are called but few are chosen. And there are many, many, many who would love to go and perform the Hajj. But we also have that belief that it is those who are chosen and by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have the opportunity to. There are people who have the money, they have the wealth, they have the health, but they have not had the tawfiq and the opportunity to go. At the end of the day, yes, Hajj is a test, it is a trial, it has some difficulties, but that's part of the process. Yet, people would love to go, and people will always love to go and perform the holy pilgrimage. And I'm saying this today because we are just back a few days ago from performing the Hajj, and there are hundreds of thousands of people who are returning back home to their countries and their family members after performing the Hajj with a lot of different experiences and learnings, etc., spiritually from the Hajj. Intellectually, they have benefited. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when you go to perform the Hajj, you benefit. There are a lot of nafa and benefits that we earn when performing the Hajj. I know a lot of times people look at the difficulties, and yes, we must accept that there are natural things like the sun, which no one has control over, the heat, the crowd. You can't choose a time to go to Hajj. There is one fixed time. Some people might say, we want to go at certain time when it's low season. But that doesn't work for Hajj. There is a time that we have to answer and respond and go and say, Labbaik, we are here, Ya Allah. So the crowd is a natural thing. The heat is a natural thing. There are other things that are not really natural and should not be natural, but it has almost become natural. Some of the administrative aspects of the Saudi government, and I could say that publicly here, I may not be able to say it in Saudi Arabia. And I'm really May Allah give us the health and strength and iman and ability to do it. We want to do a documentary on Al Hikmah TV and probably send it to the Saudi government, to the Ministry of Hajj, because there are areas that they really, 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 really need to better up on. Professionalism, proper protocol, proper system and procedures, as we have in America. There are a lot of things that they can better. And I've been going to Hajj since 1986. And yes, alhamdulillah, I must say and give credit that from 1986 to now, there have been a lot of changes for the better. There have been a lot of systems that they have implemented. But I think it's too slow. It could be better and faster. And those are areas that are really human error. Administrative weaknesses. There are, you know, sometimes you look at the roads. Yes, there are a lot of traffic, but then there is no system. Nobody respects the traffic lights. I was wondering if it's working. The lights are working, but the people are not working. Red means to go. And stop means when someone stops you. There's no law with the light. Maybe in some areas, but, you know, these things cause a lot of inconveniences. And then it leads on to difficulties to the Hujjaj and the pilgrims. A 15 and 20 minutes journey can take 5 and 6 and 10 hours because you're in circles at that time. And that has to do with administrative operation, systems, protocol. You got a lot of inexperienced people doing jobs. I remember at one place we went, they have no clue where is Trinidad. They're looking for Trinidad in San Francisco and Los Angeles. You know, some countries, because maybe the officers have no clue, they need to learn some geography to be immigration officers. When you have people from all over the world coming to perform Hajj, they need to have a little bit of that so they can go into the computers and pull up the countries accordingly. You know? So these are some areas. Then you have a lot of organizations and licensed organizations who really mismanage the operation. And unfortunately, a lot of people face a lot of unnecessary inconvenience because of the lack of good administration. I know some people consider all of that to be good. Yes, it's good, it's a blessing. But it doesn't mean that we must cause hardship on ourselves. In Islam, we are not allowed, we should not ask for hardship. As a Muslim, you don't ask for sabr. You ask not to have problems. You ask Allah, we ask Allah to remove problems and difficulties from our way. We don't ask Allah for problems and difficulties and then say, give us patience to handle it. You see, so that's where certain things have to be understood and have been misunderstood in many areas. And I really hope and pray, inshallah, that some of these things can be corrected. And it has been working, but very slowly, as we say. I mean, I don't even want to talk. I mean, this is public, it goes worldwide. But you know, Hajj is a very worldwide thing and very international. They need to probably hire some proper engineers to run a better toilet system. A simple thing like that. That has nothing to do with Hajj. An-nadhifu nisful iman. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that cleanliness is half of faith. It doesn't take a big rocket scientist to set up that. An ordinary regular handyman in America can give you a good toilet working system. So these are some of the areas they need to correct. It has nothing to do with Hajj. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam believed in cleanliness. He says it's half of iman. So I want to remind myself and remind our viewers worldwide and our people who have gone to Hajj, we need to know how to separate what are difficulties of the Hajj in the part of Allah and what are difficulties that were caused by people. At the end of the day, we have to have sabr and patience on all conditions. That's no choice. But it doesn't mean that we must continue that system. Something has to be done about it. And we are the ummah. Inna hadhihi ummatukum ummatan wahida. Wa ana rabbukum fa'budun. Allah says, we must say we are one ummah. We worship Allah in oneness. And if there is a problem that affects the Muslim ummah, and Hajj is something of the ummah, then Muslims need to talk about it, even if we can't change it with our hands. Proper systems. I mean, yes, alhamdulillah, the Jamarat, where you pelt shaitan. Once upon a time, it was total chaos when I went in 1986. It's everyone going around to pelt this pillar, right around, back, forth. So you used to have a lot of people dying regularly. They set up a nice, beautiful system, wonderful system, one way, sophisticated, escalators, high tech. But the system going to the high tech system is not very professional. Walking on the streets to get there, no directions, even the police officers don't know where you're going. And I don't want to say this because you want to beat down the system, but because you want people to better understand, separate Islam from the weaknesses of Muslims. We must not let Muslim culture and Arab culture get into what Quran and Sunnah is all about. Because sometimes people would look at this lack of proper administration by the Saudi government and think that is Islam. And then the non-Muslims may ill speak Muslims and Islam, the entire Muslim world, or he'll speak Islam for that. And we need to understand the difference with those things. There's a difference with Islam and Muslims. So what I'm saying, yes, systems are being set up, but then you don't have a proper roadway system with proper direction because the police officers themselves don't know which way to go. They're just like robots in some cases. Do this, do that. And they have no clue. So, but at the end of the day, I don't want to say it's only the fault there, but even in America, you have these kind of problems sometimes. You have immigration officers in America. They have no clue what's going on. They ask you some stupid questions that make no sense. And they're very educated and sophisticated people. Some are also trained to ask stupid questions to see if you'll ask stupid. So, you know, it happens. You go into a store sometimes, into Best Buy and some of these shops here in America. So I don't want to really downplay America, the Saudis alone. You walk into some shops, a computer shop here or there. One guy, he specializes in selling one thing. He has no clue of something next to him. He does not even know. He might sell you something and can't even plug it on. He doesn't even know how it works. Right here in America, I've seen that level of stupidity also. And I call it stupidity. Because they work just for a job, like robots, boom. And they know nothing else. And we have those problems, but Islam is far ahead of those problems. This Quran is a book of wisdom, hikmah, high tech. The Quran is very high tech, modern, intellectual. And these are problems of human beings, and it happens all over the world. You go all over the world, you see this kind of problem happening. But the reason why I'm saying this, my brothers and sisters, is so that, you know, there are some people who don't want to go to Hajj because they allow these problems to keep them back. I'm saying you should not let these problems keep you back. This is the trial and test that we have to go through. And that's what I'm saying. You also have some of those kind of problems here. You have politicians in America condemning and criticizing Islam. It's politicians in America making money for their campaign because they bad talk Muslims and Islam. You have that level also here. It's all kind of things. We live in a world, we live in a time with so many different problems and issues. But it is very important, my brothers and sisters, as Muslims, that we live by the Quran and the Sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what makes the difference. The akhlaq, the characteristics of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what we have learned in Islam, the sunnah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, we don't follow other people. We don't allow culture in Muslim countries or wherever we live to lead our path, but we live by the Quran and we live our life by the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for us. And as we have seen exemplified in the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So today, in the next 10-15 minutes, inshallah, in the second khutbah, I want to remind myself and remind you, those of us who have been to the Hajj, those who have not been to the Hajj, those who intend to, those who have been many years ago, a little reminder on some of the lessons that we have learned and some of the benefits of the Hajj and the pilgrimage and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, inshallah. I want to share that with myself and remind you about that in the second khutbah, inshallah. And how we should now benefit and continue to benefit from what we have learned and experienced in the Holy Land and from the pilgrimage, the fifth pillar of Islam, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah without reckoning, inshallah. Wa akhir da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alam.
Al-Hikmat Services, serving the Muslim community and non-Muslim community. Dawah and interfaith activities, distribution of Quran and Islamic publications, sponsoring students to study Islam, Al-Hikmat Da'i, Dawah and Interfaith Institute. Also, Friday sermons by Shaikh Shafayat are live on alhikmattv.com from 1:30 to 2:30 p.m. Download our free Al-Hikmat TV app on your mobile devices. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Instagram and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Feel free to donate to Al-Hikmat Dawah Services online with a credit card or PayPal at alhikmat.com. For more details, contact Al-Hikmat office at 1-800-804-0267 or our local number 954-986-0158 and visit us at www.alhikmat.com. Jazakallah khair.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu. ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Once more, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us to be here today to perform the Salatul Jumu'ah and to listen to the khutbah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His peace and blessings unto the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ala alihi wa sahabihi ajma'in. I once more ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His rahmah, His mercy, His guidance, His forgiveness, and His acceptance upon each and every one of us. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His rahmah, His mercy upon me by giving me the permission and the ability to continue with the second khutbah, inshallah. I seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help. I seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower unto me the quality of tawakkal Allah, the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the taqwa, the piety, the iman, the faith, the hikmah, the wisdom, the ilm, the knowledge, and the ability to fulfill this responsibility in delivering the khutbah, inshallah. I put my tawakkal, I put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most sufficient. I would like to remind myself and remind you of this ayah and this verse of the Quran taken from Surah Hajj. Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse 27. Very nice, interesting ayah pertaining to Hajj. And as I said, we're still in the month of Hajj. I know Hajj days have gone, but we can still remind ourselves and benefit from some of the lessons of the Hajj. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa adhin fin nas وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. Very interesting. Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse 27. And proclaim the Hajj to all insan. And Allah uses the word insan, human beings. So it is a blessing to remind people, to invite people, to proclaim the Hajj, the call to Hajj. And it's not necessary that you remind people to perform Hajj the year before Hajj comes, but we can remind from now. So people can make the intention and prepare to go to Hajj for next year, inshallah. Because it's an order in the Quran, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. And proclaim to the people about Hajj. And then Allah says, يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ذَامِرٍ. Very interesting. And they will come walking. Subhanallah. And they will come walking. وَعَلَى كُلِّ ذَامِرٍ. And here, ذَامِر really refers to, according to the Mufassirin, healthy, well, here they say lean, and Mufassirin have explained what it means. Lean camels, means of transportation, good buses, bad buses, working air condition, non-working air condition. This is a word that has been used in those days. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used this word for the people at that time. But it's so compact that we can put it in the perspective of this time. You know, buses that are good and buses that are not good. Comfortable and not comfortable. It's just a figure of speech that Allah is using here. And then he says, Ya atina min kulli fajjin amiqa. And he's saying, proclaim this Hajj and people will come walking by camels. And not only by camels, could be by aircraft, by ship, by buses, walking. يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍّ عَمِيقٍ. And this is again is a figure of speech here, where Allah is saying when he uses the word عَمِيق, فَجٍّ عَمِيق, through the valleys, between the mountains. And in those days, they would have used that example because for the people there, they would have understood mountains, through the mountains, the valleys. Really and truly, if you put this in today's perspective, it would mean, and people will come from everywhere. All over the world, worldwide. Subhanallah, look at the miracle of this ayah. In those days, you did not have the millions of Muslims to what this verse is speaking about. And this verse in itself is a miracle of the Quran and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has been mentioned since then. Min kulli fajjin amiq, from everywhere and anywhere. Anywhere you could think about. Any mountain part where. That people would not imagine there are people living there. People will come from everywhere worldwide. Allahu Akbar. That's very deep. That is a reality because Hajj, my brothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, today, it is really the world's largest spiritual gathering of its nature and type. The world's largest spiritual gathering of that nature. And this verse and what we see going on in the world today, this verse from Surah Hajj, chapter 22, verse 27, is a proof again of the reality, the practicality of Islam. Allahu Akbar. That what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed 1,500 years ago, today we see it happening in reality. Not only are people going to perform Hajj worldwide, from everywhere and every corner, but so many people want to go to perform Hajj that they can't even get visas to go. Subhanallah. A reality of the hakikat of the Quran. Islam. You know, Islam, subhanallah. That's why it is that Islam will prevail, inshallah. That this is a reality. Forget about even the Hajj, the practicality of this existing. Many years, 1500 years ago, and in the time of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, thousands of years ago, when Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was commanded to call people, and he asked Allah, "Where are the people? You have commanded me to call people, but I don't see anybody to call." Allah says, "Your job is to call, and I will send them." A person who has no iman and faith in Allah would never believe in Islam. I said, "What is this? Where are the people? Who are the people? What are you talking about?" Today, look at the people and the millions all over the world. This verse is a reality. You know, these are some of the verses in the Quran that we can use to show to the world the power of Islam, the success of Islam, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the truth of Islam. You know, as I speak of the truth of Islam, yesterday, Brother Azad was here for Zuhar, and I had a colonel from the U.S. Army, from the South Command. He's a colonel from the U.S. Army, South Command. When I came back, I got an email stating that he wanted to meet me. So I was like, what is so important that he wants to meet me? And I thought he wanted me to come and meet him down at the U.S. Command office. So I found it very strange. He just called, he wanted to meet me. And he came. I told him, we set up a time, 3:00 yesterday, so he came. And I'm just sharing this with you because of Allahu Akbar, the reality of Islam, how the power of Islam works. So he came, we went upstairs in the office. Looked very straight, very forward. He pulled out a Quran from he came in his U.S. Army uniform, and he pulled out a Quran, a nice pocket Quran, and he held it in his hand, but it was zipped. And I was wondering, Quran? He brought a Quran for me? So I couldn't figure what's going on. And then he started telling me, he said, "Sheikh, I need to make a confession. And I wanted to clear something from my heart. I want to have a peace of heart. And I'm going to resign, or I'm retiring in a year from the U.S. Army. And there's something in my mind that I just feel that I need to clear because of my love for God, my peace of mind." So I said, "What is it?" He said, "When I were in Iraq, 1990, which is what, 25 years ago, he said, I was there in Desert Storm, and you know, with the war and the whole nine yards, I don't need to tell you." So he's telling me. He said, "After the war and whatever, you know, after capturing people and the whole thing, they bring back the things that they get from the people that are captives or killed or whatever." He said, "And amongst those things that I brought back, I've always had this Quran. And I cannot destroy this. It was never in me to destroy this. And today I feel at peace that I could pass this Quran on to you." Because after time, some of the things that are of no need, they just straight away get rid of it, keep it in archives or whatever. He said, "But I just want to make peace with my Lord." This was his words. He said, "I want to make peace with my Lord. And I want to pass this Quran on to you, of whoever it belonged to in Iraq, in the Desert Storm, in the war. I just want to pass this on to you. You could make good use of it. Because keeping it down in the office and there, I don't know what someone will do with it, what will happen after. But I wanted to pass it on." And he gave me a Quran. Here is a colonel, Christian, U.S. Army man, giving me a Quran from Desert Storm, Iraq War in 1990. So there are a lot of good people that still exist, my brothers and sisters. It's important to understand how Allah works. And he understands the reality of Islam. We have a very good, you know, godly relationship. And he felt peace at heart to take a Quran and bring it and give it. And I admire that in the brother. And the reason why I brought this up is to remind myself and you that, you know, if we as Muslims really live the right life and we demonstrate the true Quran and Sunnah, people will come to Islam. And even if they don't come to Islam, they will respect Islam. They will respect the Muslims. Just as this colonel respected the Quran and he said, I want to bring it and give it to you here. And that's the least we can at least do. Think about Abu Talib, the father of Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He never accepted Islam, but he respected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He respected Islam and he did whatever he could do to make sure no one harmed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and harmed the Muslims and Islam, whatever he could have done. So that's very important. And it's important that we understand these things as Muslims. And we can only learn this from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in sharing this verse, my brothers and sisters, of Surah Hajj chapter 22, verse 27, of people coming from all over. You know, some of the lessons that we have learned, and I mean, time does not permit to get into all the lessons, but one of the things you learn, and last night in our little Hajj Shukrana program here, one brother mentioned it, I don't remember who it was, very interesting, one of the hafiz, that one thing when you go to perform Hajj and you see the millions of people, you realize how insignificant we are. Doesn't matter how wealthy we are, how educated we are, what a degree we have here, what a house we have here, what a car we have here, what a job we have here, what a position we have here, what an authority we have here, what a power we have here. When we go there, we realize we are nobody. We are just a number. And not even a number. There are millions of people who are dying for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are millions of people who are dying for the love of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in addition to performing the Hajj, one of the things you see is how much love people have for Allah. As they reach into Makkah, they reach there, put on the ihram, is labbaik, Allahumma labbaik, ya Allah, we are here. It's just the love for Allah. They go to Masjid al-Nabawi, the love for the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sometimes people become so selfish, they don't want another person to even get in the line. Now that is crossing the boundaries. That's not right Islamically. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, la yu'minu ahadukum hatta yuhibbu li akhihi ma yuhibbu li nafsihi. You are not a true believer until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. So sometimes in all the excitement and the emotion and the love for Allah and His Rasul, people don't want other people to touch the Kaaba. They don't want other people to get in line to give the salam to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is getting a little extreme. But that's one part. On the other hand, what we see is we might sit back here in Florida and say, I don't need that trouble in Saudi Arabia. I don't need to go there to perform Hajj. I don't need that crowd. But Allah doesn't need you neither. Because there are millions of people who are dying just to say, Allah, we are here, labbaik, Allahumma labbaik. That's one thing you really learn when you go there. See how very insignificant it is. How we are nothing. And therefore, we need to want to be something in answering to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's very important. Another thing we learn, brothers and sisters, and those of you who have been there and learned that, I pray that Allah gives us the hidayah, the guidance, and the tawfiq, and the opportunity, the iman, the faith, the courage, to continue to understand and live by that understanding. You know that ihram, Allahu Akbar, that two pieces of cloth that people tie, white, men especially? It is so interesting. That forget about all the spirituality of it. Let's get into the physical, materialistic aspect. When everybody wear that two little simple piece of cloth, you really don't know who is an engineer and who is a doctor. Who is wealthy, who is poor. Not at all. That's one of the hikmah in that simplicity. It brings everybody down and humbles everybody. And you could be what millionaire? And what doctor and what engineer and what billionaire here in America, you realize I'm very insignificant. Nobody cares who I am or who you are. They really don't care. You make a miss, they walk over you.
your house and size and whatever we have is nothing. That's a lesson to show how insignificant we are. We may think that we are somebody here, but really in the eyes of Allah, it is only our taqwa and our piety that counts. Those things that we think we are somebody here is nothing in the eyes of Allah. And you don't need to see the day of Qiyamah to understand that. That's the point I want to get at, my brothers and sisters. We don't need to wait for the day of judgment to realize that haqiqat, that reality. Just go into Arafah on the day of Hajj and you will realize that haqiqat and reality. Like the plains on the day of judgment as it would be. Nothing of who we think we are, but our amal, our deeds, our taqwa, our piety, our love and our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what counts. That's very deep. And those of us who have performed the Hajj and come back, keep that in mind. Don't let arrogance walk over us. You know, when you're in Hajj, arrogance just humbles itself. You know, here people push themselves around, brothers. You know that. People can gallivant here in America. I am this, I am that. I got 40 businesses. I own a lot of money. When you go there, nobody wants to even know who you are. You don't even pull that by immigration. It doesn't count. Nobody cares. And if nobody cares who we are, you think Allah really cares about our million of dollars and our position and our jobs? Regular human beings don't care who you are. Allah looks at our piety and our taqwa. And that's a very interesting lesson we can learn right here on this earth. Because everybody looks the same. And even if a man thinks he's better than somebody, he cannot exercise it because that has no power across there. There are so many people. We have been dealing with people in our tents. You know, before they left, one guy is like, I'm a brain. One guy is like, something he was talking, and then I realized he's a doctor, a brain specialist. And I'm like, I thought he was probably a handyman somewhere. Believe me. I thought the guy was a handyman, only to know he's a brain specialist. He was moving around the tent, walking around, what to do, what not to do, how to do this. I got to share this before we hang up. We conclude the khutbah. I shared it last night with the brothers, and I got to share this. There was another brother. How we become simple and humble, and arrogance don't work. When you see all these people in the love for Allah, and all these people praying to Allah, and all these people humbling themselves, you realize that we have nothing in comparison to what others have. And you think you're somebody and you're running to somebody better than you with materialistic things and they're more humble than us. And it brings us right down. So there was this brother. Very interesting. And you know, after I think, his humbleness, his love for Allah, and his simplicity was like a barakat for him in Hajj. There was this brother. I wouldn't say country or where or what. He got lost for a day and a half, went up Jabal Rahmah out of his love for Allah. He went, then he, because of the crowd and the people, he got misplaced with another group and we lost him for a day and a half or so. And when he got lost and he came back after a day and a half, and you know, he started telling me how he felt like a beggar. He kept on using the word miskeen. He said, everybody treated me like a miskeen, like a beggar. He said, because I had no ID. Nobody knew I'm from America. No ID. No money. Because he left his bag with his money. His everything in the tent. No money, no ID. Nothing he had. His phone, the minutes ran out. No, he also left his phone in the tent at that time. Interesting. And people just treated him like nobody. See how interesting it is. When I met him a day and a half after, I want to cut a long story short, and I just happened to meet him because he came to me to ask me to use my phone to call his wife. I want you to learn the lesson. Let's pay heed to that lesson. He said, and it's not that I don't have any money, you know, but my phone doesn't have money right now. I need to go and put money in it. So he was trying to, you know, not make me think that he really wants me to do a favor, but and he's just going to call her so she could call him back. And in that conversation, finding out who he is and where he's from and some more details about his life, I came to learn the man has a house worth $1.2 million. And he got two of that. And he bought his wife a gift before he left to go to Hajj. Because he says, the Prophet says, you must make your wife and children happy before you go to Hajj. So I'm like, what you did? He bought her Mercedes Benz for $100,000 cash. But in the Holy Land, he said, I was like a beggar. See what you learn? You may be a king here, but in the eyes of Allah, we are a beggar. That's why it's Abdullah. You know in Arabic? What is the title of a Muslim? Abdullah, the slave of Allah. Your millions and your billions worth nothing. And here is a brother who, I didn't read that in a book. The man came to me to ask me to make a call. And asking him who or what he is and where he's from, I learned that. And there are other brothers in the group who know that story. And not only that, after that incident, the man had a garbage bag cleaning the tent. A man who is blessed with millions in US dollars, and I didn't mean a millionaire in rupees, or taka, or dhaka, or whatever you call it. Okay? Millionaire in dollars, US dollars. But he felt what it was like to be a beggar in the eyes of Allah. But I admire that, and I in my own, I'm like, I have known people who disappeared, and they did not come back so easy. But his kindness, his humbleness, his simplicity, he was so kind and humble and simple that Allah made his pathway easy for him, that he found back the group and he came back very natural. Very natural. So, you know, brothers and sisters, you have a lot of lessons we learn. And one of the main lesson in this is the love for Allah. Just to answer the call, that's why the dhikr in the Holy Land is labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Allah, I'm here. I've left everything. My wife, my family, my children, my business, my money, my properties, all for my love for you. That supersedes all. And we go and give salam to the Prophet in Medina out of our love for the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's all about the love. And it takes away that materialistic arrogance and ego from people. It brings us down. Sometimes the arrogance gets people angry and mad. But when they come to realize, they realize, well, what could I do with my anger and my arrogance? Nothing. But pray to Allah. It's very interesting, my brothers and sisters. Time does not permit to go on. But there are many, 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 many lessons that we can learn from the Hajj. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Hajj. You know, it's just about just answering. Go. And obey Allah for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah says, those who don't care, He doesn't need us. He does not need us. Those who reject the call, He doesn't need us. And when you go to Hajj, you really see that. How the millions and the millions of people love Allah and they won't need Allah. So we need to join that bandwagon, as we say. Because Allah doesn't really care. And not that He doesn't care about us. I don't want you to miss that point. Yes, He cares and He loves us. But I don't want us to have an arrogance to think that Allah needs us and Islam needs us. No, that's the point I want to get at. Allah loves everyone and cares for everyone. His mercy is upon everyone. But Allah does not need us and Islam does not need us. We need Allah and we need the barakat of the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's what we need to make this effort and this sacrifice for, inshallah. And we must try to, last but not least, try not to be selfish, my brothers and sisters. That's something I have noticed in Hajj. I've noticed people who are selfish, they suffer a lot. You try to always care for somebody else, love for somebody else, do for somebody else. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, those who are kind to others al-ard on earth, those who have mercy and kindness for people on earth, Allah in the heavens will be kind and merciful to them. So that's another thing we learn in Hajj, because everyone is about themselves. Everybody want to kiss the stone alone. Everybody want to stand and give salam to the Prophet alone. Everybody want to eat the best food alone. Everybody want to be in the front line. Everybody want to get the best of the best. But if you care for somebody else and give way for somebody else, then Allah in the heavens will care for us. That's another thing we need to learn. And it's not only to practice in the Holy Land, but we must practice it here also. It's a lesson so we could become like that every time. That's very important in life. Humbleness, simplicity, don't be selfish, and Allah will be kind and loving to us and give us more, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, ya Allah, ya Rahman, Rahim, ya Ghafur, Rahim. Ya Allah, we thank thee for all the favors and bounties you have bestowed upon us, ya Allah. We ask thee, Allah, to send your peace and blessings unto the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ya Allah. We ask thee, Allah, to accept the Hajj of all those brothers and sisters who have been there to perform your Hajj, ya Allah. Ya Allah, all those brothers and sisters who have had problems and difficulties, and make everything easy for them, ya Allah. Ya Allah, those brothers and sisters who have lost their lives in their love and in struggle for you and in your path, ya Allah, grant them Jannah, ya Allah. Put that peace and that itminan qalb and that sakina and tranquility in the hearts of their family members that they have left behind, ya Allah. And give them that understanding, and give us all that understanding. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajoon. That we belong to you, Allah, and to you is our return, ya Allah. We ask thee, Allah, to save us all from calamities and disasters and diseases and sicknesses, ya Allah. And to give us all the good in this world and the good in the hereafter, inshallah. Allahumma rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhaban. Inna Allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina maulana Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammadin bi adadi man salla wa sam. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina maulana Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammadin bi adadi man qa'ada wa qam. Wa salli ala jamil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala kulli malaikatika al muqarrabin wa ala ibadillahi salihin bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Ibadallah, inna Allaha ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. Wa la dhikrullahi ta'ala a'la wa a'la wa 'azza wa jalla wa hamu akbar. Allahu akbar. Aqimus salat.